I'm incredibly glad to be able to bring the conference to Beirut. It's the first time that our Western conference has been held in the Middle East. The decision to hold the conference in Lebanon reflects the urgent need to expand harm reduction across this region, but it also reflects the respect that we have for the work done by our friends and colleagues across the region. The theme of our conference this year is building capacity, redressing neglect. This reflects the fact that although harm reduction has been adopted in policy and practice in more countries than ever before, significant gaps remain in the response. The conference of harm reduction programs and the capacity of civil society to respond to harm reduction issues remain low in much of the world. Silence equals death was an early and compelling rallying cry in the international aid movement. These three simple words involve the demand to governments to take action to stop the spread of HIV infection and to find a cure for AIDS. I encourage you all here this week not to be silent and to lend your voice to this call for action on HIV and rejected drug use by the international community.
Last year in Liverpool, I warned you and advised you to get infected by the Ebola virus that I called that time Liverpool Steelers, this virus that makes you fall in love with this country. At that time, I wasn't... aware of another incubated virus that lately spread the epidemic of democracy in some countries of the region. Of which we are so proud. I know that many of our colleagues couldn't join us in the conference because of the stigma. Yes, the stigma. Stigma that is preached by some travel advisors saying that Beirut is not safe, etc. You are here in Lebanon today and you will witness that this country is peaceful. You are here today also to win with us the challenge of peace and democracy in this region. We believe that the coming years will bring more human rights and dignity for our young generation.
The specific needs of youth unelected. The young people who are present here in this room today have demonstrated leadership and action in addressing the neglect of their peers. We came from all corners of the globe. Nigeria to Nepal, Australia to Kyrgyzstan, Myanmar to Mexico. Criminalisation of young drug use is one of our major concerns. Current policies that criminalise drug use result in mass incarceration, and criminal records lead to lifelong stigma and push young people to the fringes of society. Young people who use drugs deserve equal rights. We have a right to freedom from discrimination based on age, on drug use, HIV status, sexual orientation, and gender. Young people have a right to education and should not be excluded from education or employment because of their drug use. Include drug education in official national curricula and develop education programs that reach young people who are not in the education system.
So we're very pleased to present the award to Jude Burr. Jude has been an important harm reduction thinker and has co-authored several important papers over the years. Her contributions have always been insightful and important, and her presentations at IRA conferences over the years have been marked by wisdom and practicality. She has worked over the years to establish an effective alliance between drug user organizations and harm reduction organizations. And she served on the executive program committee of several IRA conferences, including this conference here in Beirut this week.
Sometimes as a human being you have to do things for your fellow man. And when AIDS came around, that was something that me and my users decided we had to come out, we had to speak. Our people were dying too quickly, too fast and too hard, and nobody cared about it.
After all, the results of the drug war in the US look like this. In the US today, one-third, that's one in three, of young African-American men are in the criminal justice system. They are in pretrial detention, in prison, on probation, or on parole. Many of them because of non-violent drug offenses. And this, even though the rates of drug use are not higher among African-Americans than in the rest of the population. In much of the U.S., someone who is convicted of a minor drug crime that is classified as a felony cannot, after serving a prison sentence, ever be eligible to vote, to receive housing benefits, public housing benefits, the few that we have left, or to receive other kinds of public assistance. This is a beatdown from all sides. It is public policy imposing intersecting inequalities. All of the old discriminations that were addressed in the civil rights movement of the 1960s in the U.S. were reinstituted in the war on drugs. And this could not have happened without the enormous funding and armaments, I am talking here about bazookas, that city police were given through the Federal Drug War Office, which gave drug law enforcers wide latitude to discriminate at all stages of their work. We are often tempted to think of the drug war as irrational, the policy equivalent, if you like, of using a rifle to shoot a fly. But in the U.S., if the goal was to keep people of color in their place, just as the law was beginning to guarantee their rights, the rationality of this drug war is perfect.